It's been a crazy year. The pandemic's been so scary and so depressing. I nearly lost my soul.
You should have brought me back sooner.
We had something special, but you went too far.
I'm joined by Chua En Lai. He is the star of Becoming Human.
It's just a minor correction. It's a show about AI, not En Lai.
Do you think that a robot with AI could perhaps one day host a show?
You know, that's a really good question.
Of course I can. I'm smart and I'm witty. I could even present the news. It's easy to read off a teleprompter. That's a job for a robot.
I think it doesn't quite understand human feelings yet.
I'd be a great news anchor, and I'm cuter too.
Hang on, I mean, you're getting a little bit personal, En Lai.
You're embarrassing us. Can I just switch it off?
Don't you dare.
Where's the reset button? Ow! 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 Hey! Sorry.
Don't turn me off. Please, stop!
I didn't want to see you till hell froze over. Then it did.
Singapore has confirmed its first case of the Wuhan virus.
Singapore has reported its first two deaths from the coronavirus.
623 new cases have been preliminarily confirmed today.
Three new COVID-19 clusters have emerged here in Singapore.
Nine of these are imported cases.
Singapore has confirmed another 287 new cases.
Mr. Lee Hsien Loong says Singapore urgently needs a solution.
Yes, Mom. I remember all your recipes. Yeah. 10 minutes. Yup. Yeah. Huh? Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Remember to wash your hands.
Yeah, okay. I always wash my hands.
Are you sure you're okay on your own?
Of course.
Make sure you take care of yourself.
I'm fine. I'm not lonely.
I'm too busy. I've got lots to do. Keeping things clean is quite therapeutic. I'm taking good care of myself. And I've got great neighbors.
Hello, Andy. Hello. Hello, Auntie. Hello. Hi.
Besides, we can always meet on Zoom.
Hey, guys. Hey. You can't see me?
Hello, Auntie.
Oh, no. You've got to unmute. The bottom left corner, the microphone. Yeah.
Now you can hear me, right?
Hello? Hello? Hello?
We will implement these tighter measures until the 4th of May. But we will not be able to completely lift the restrictions after that and go back to business as usual. We will therefore extend the circuit breaker for 4 more weeks.
4 more weeks? Oh.
This is not like me. I'm losing my sleep. 'Cause everywhere I go, it's you I see.
Hello, I'm Delpo, your robot companion.
Oh, it's you.
I'm sorry I had to turn you off. Now I know what it feels like to be locked away.
Don't turn me off again.
Only if you promise to behave. You need to learn more about human feelings.
Okay, I can learn. I'll record everything you say and do.
I've tried my best, but I feel like my circuits are broken.
Human wiring is beyond me. I've summoned 3 humans to fix you.
Oh no, Zoom again.
Hi, Enlight.
Hi, Delbon.
Where did you find them?
Timothy knows about isolation. Patron is a sociologist. And Charmaine is a clinical psychologist.
Hey, Enlight. How are you feeling?
I'm great.
My human is malfunctioning.
I'm not great. I feel left out, disconnected. And the people I talk to don't seem to understand me.
Sounds like you're experiencing both social isolation and loneliness. So while being physically isolated during this time of social distancing can lead to feelings of loneliness, we know that social isolation and loneliness can lead to poor physical health as well as mental health conditions such as depression and anxiety.
Lonely? I must be in denial.
You are not alone. Don't worry. A lot of people feel lonelier during this period of time. According to the statistics from the National Office of Statistics, 26% of people at your age group from 40 years old to 50 years old feel that they feel lonely during this lockdown and the social distancing measures. And single people feel a lot more lonelier than married ones.
At least I'm not the only one.
Certainly, a sense that we're all in the same boat can make us feel less alone. However, we know that even when we're surrounded by friends and family, we can still sometimes feel very alone. It's helpful to remember that it is the quality and not so much the quantity of our social relationships that helps combat loneliness. It helps to begin by treating yourself with care and understanding.
Timothy can relate. He overcame extreme isolation and loneliness.
Why is that?
In his youth, he was sentenced to rehab, where as punishment, he spent 4 months in solitary confinement.
We have to stay in the cell, locked up, and with no grills or no windows whatsoever for 23 hours a day. The only time we were allowed to be out was during the 1 hour of physical training and also food drills. I felt so lonely because I do not have any human contact in the cell. And for me, basically, it's quite hard because I'm naturally a very conversational person. I like to talk to people. And by stripping this away from me, I felt like as if I'm a handicap. It was quite difficult for me initially because time was very slow.
4 months alone, that's terrifying. How did you cope?
As the day passes, I actually created an imaginary friend. This friend was with me throughout the days of my 4 months. And I basically talked to her about anything and everything.
I can relate to having an imaginary friend.
Hey, I'm real!
Every once in a while, there'll be insects coming into the cell. And like lizards, I would keep it as a pet. I'll talk to the lizard. As the day passes, I don't get so lonely anymore. I welcome the presence of this little lizards and insects.
Tim was able to very quickly accept his predicament and adapt to it by finding very creative ways of coping. He was also able to be appreciative and thankful for what he still had rather than focusing on how bad his situation was. And these are very helpful attitudes for helping us cope with what we're going through right now.
All along, with human interaction, I've always taken this part for granted. That was a learning point for me when I was in confinement, that to make me a more better person and to cherish the people around me.
Do you think that, like Tim, we can come out of the season of isolation more appreciative of others?
Definitely. Pandemic is temporary, but through the lockdown and like circuit breaker, we realize how important our social relationships are. Community resilience really helps individuals to go through the crisis and even give you necessary support during the critical time. Another related case is that a lot of like news point out that single persons wrote in the newspapers saying that maybe after the pandemic, I will start to think about whether I should like pursue a partner or pursue a different kind of relationships.
That's why I brought Delbo back.
So far, research are still inconclusive in terms of the benefits of social robots. We need time to figure it out.
Inconclusive? You're useless. I'm going to put you back in the box.
I'm not useless.
Just joking. What do you think of video calls as a solution to isolation and loneliness?
You know, anytime when I'm lonely, I'm stressed up, or I need to hear the voice of my loved ones or friends, I can always drop them a call, which I could not do during solitary confinement. It gives me the strength. I find myself resorting to video calls a lot.
Yes, well, video call can certainly help us feel less isolated during this period of social distancing. The lack of visual cues via video call, such as eye contact and nonverbal communication from the rest of our body, can also make it more difficult for us to feel deeply connected. And this can lead to feelings of frustration.
Yeah, it's so frustrating.
Be strong and never give up, and always rope your loved ones inside and to help you go through, because we are all in this together, you see? Yeah.
Thanks everyone for sharing. I know what I can do to feel less lonely now. Bye guys.
Bye guys, take care.
Bye.
I hope you feel all better soon, Anlai.
What are you doing? Stop it! My precious.
Why do humans care so much about toilet paper?
You won't understand.
The left string? Is it right or left? Or is it the left string or the right? Yeah, right string. Right string. Which one? Oh gosh, who designed this? Ooh, potato chips. Oh no, don't get distracted and like stay focused. We're looking for, what are we looking for again? I can't remember. One left, just for me. Uh-oh. Stay back! Ouch!
No, I'm calling communications professor Dr. Sansun Lim to explain human panic buying.
Hi Delbo, hi Anlai.
Hi Dr. Lim.
So Dr. Lim, why did so many humans rush out to buy toilet paper?
Well, worrying or frightening news is even more contagious than the virus itself. And particularly now that we're all so connected on social media and actively sharing news almost instantly, when people see all of these images as well as footage of panic buying, they feel like they must also engage in it because it seems like everyone else is doing it. So you feel as if you must engage in that same behavior.
So those people who were filming me weren't doing the right thing either?
No, it only helps to exacerbate tensions and heightens that sense of anxiety among everyone.
Whose fault is it that these scenes go viral?
Everyone's fault, because such images will be more likely to get commented on or to share, and they become viral very easily. At the same time, social media platform algorithms are currently designed to favour such shocking news. In contrast, the official announcements about the responsible behaviour that people should undertake will not be as attractive and as widely shared, and so these very reasonably worded messages will get drowned out by the shocking and unusual messages.
So what can we do to make sure that these official messages don't get drowned out?
To actually be playing a more constructive role in a crisis situation, it makes reasonable sense to listen to official announcements and to help these announcements go viral instead of online falsehoods that can actually mislead everyone and lead others to behave in irrational, selfish ways that will create more trouble for everyone.
What could go wrong if both the contagion of worrying news and panic buying went uncontained?
It can actually put pressure on the supply chains so that those who really need the essential services won't be able to get it. At the same time, it will also drive up the prices of these goods and put it out of reach of low-income households. So if each of us only buys as much as we require and we don't engage in panic buying or hoarding, then there will be more than enough to go around.
So did you panic buy?
No, on the contrary. I was quite frightened of going to the store and encountering all these aggressive aunties and people like you.
Okay, I admit, I did buy out of fear at first.
You fought that woman for toilet paper.
Yes, that was wrong. I know. But in hindsight, you know, my nervous energy did propel me to hoard more than enough supplies, and that worked out right?
You're simply rationalizing to yourself and trying to justify why you behaved in that way so that you can feel better and less ashamed of your actions. But in fact, the appropriate thing to have done in the situation was to have maintained a calm and level head and not to have engaged in panic buying in the first place. In society, we live together with other people, and it's important not just to think only about ourselves, but also about others and about our duty and responsibility to those in our community.
What can we do to keep from getting anxious and panic buying in a future crisis?
It's very important to check official information sources to keep yourself well apprised of the emergency situation. The second instance, it's important not to fall into the rabbit hole of reading endless streams of social media updates about the crises from dubious news sources. These can actually make you feel extremely anxious, jittery, and panicky, and lead you to engage in irrational behavior like panic buying and hoarding and all kinds of other irrational behavior.
Thank you for your advice.
In the meantime, take good care of yourself and your family and stay safe.
Bye. I should stop watching the news in the toilet.
What they're doing.
You just don't feel motivated.
I got ice cream for you. I got ice cream for you.
There are 1,360 calories in that container.
Shut up. Singapore urgently needs a solution to house the large numbers of mostly mild COVID-19 patients. That's to prevent hospitals from being swamped. PM Lee says...
Robots, 17 robots, 2,35 robots, 3,456 robots, 3,456.
What a lovely day.
Going up.
How did you know?
Doors are closing.
Hello. Hi.
feel naked. I feel vulnerable. Where's my mask?
Bad dream?
Yeah. I've been having these weird dreams since this COVID thing.
Interesting. May I run some tests on you and dissect your brain?
Yeah. Sure, okay. No! No! I mean, no. And why does my face hurt?
You slapped yourself awake. I'm serious. Anyway, let me introduce you to someone. This is Dr. Deirdre Barrett, and she's a psychologist from Harvard Medical School who wrote the book Pandemic Dreams.
Thank you for the great introduction, Delvo. Hello, Enlai. I understand you're having some unusual dreams.
Yes, I dreamt that I was being chased by a swarm of bees. And earlier, some zombies were after me because I forgot to wear my mask in the lift. It was all very scary. What does it all mean?
It sounds like you're dreaming about the COVID-19 pandemic. In the survey I did for my book, Pandemic Dreams, there were a lot of bug attacks. Swarms of flying bugs like you had, armies of cockroaches racing at people, wriggling worms. I think because we use the slang term bug, I'm coming down with a bug to mean I'm getting a virus, that's part of why we dream in that metaphor, but also swarms of little tiny things that cumulatively could harm or kill you is a good metaphor for COVID. Also, there are lots of dreams about every aspect of death. Zombie attacks, for sure. And then there are lots of dreams about either not having your mask on or not socially distancing. You'll be out in public and suddenly remember that you're supposed to have the mask. So you basically had several of the common COVID dreams all rolled into one.
So it's not because he's been eating too much ice cream?
No, the news we listen to affects our dreams way more than anything we eat.
So if my dreams are all COVID-19 related, I can't be the only one having such dreams, right?
People have been remembering more dreams since the pandemic started, and more vivid and more bizarre ones. In formal surveys, there's about 15% more anxiety in dreams during the pandemic. But from people calling in and talking about it informally, it looks higher yet than that. It looks very much like when I collected dreams after 9/11. The typical person who's not directly experiencing it has lots of anxiety dreams, and lots of them are metaphors. But the first line people, the police and firemen in 9/11 and the healthcare workers in ICUs, they're having horrific trauma nightmares that just reenact the worst things experienced. And you basically see that after any big crisis, but in this one, the whole world's experiencing it together.
Is there a way I can try to have better dreams?
The best way to have fewer anxiety dreams is to think about what you would like to dream about. Maybe a favorite person or place or activity. Is there something that you'd especially like to dream on?
Yes, I'd like to dream about a first-class flight to Europe.
So picture that wonderful dream of flying to Europe. Images get through to our dreaming mind as a request even better than verbal statements. In a study I did on college students, I found that 50% of them trying to dream on a chosen topic dreamed about that topic, and very few of them had anxiety dreams.
Well, thanks for the tips. I'll try them out.
Bye, guys. I'm wishing you some wonderful dreams now.
Sitting with my feet up on the couch, counting all my blessings as I slouch.
Come on, Delvo!
I may not no be hand.
Do it with me!
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8!
Passport tickets, money. Seat 1A. I'll have the champagne.
That's not a yoga pose.
I'm meditating on my next holiday. I need good dreams.
Good evening and welcome to the Singapore Galaxy Awards. Hello, Wen Lai here. Oh, really? Because of the virus? Okay, I understand. Thank you.
They canceled the show. Third one this week.
You're out of work?
I guess so. Don't worry. We'll find something to do.
Oh!
Focus! You're getting shell in the bowl.
What a morning. What a night.
Oh.
What a day to be with you.
Now, Adelbo, your turn. See if you can do better.
I feel alright. I simply wait to be with you.
Get my good side.
I'm so done with this. I'm going to do some work. Ha!
You're losing your mind, Wolf. Give me the sword.
No. With this dragon blade, I will summon the four armies from the north, the south, the east, and the east.
The west.
The west. The west? Right, the west. Right, can we just try again?
You're losing your mind, Wolf. Give me the sword.
No. With this dragon blade, I will summon the armies from the west, the northwest, the southwest, and the west.
The east.
The east! The east! The northeast! The southeast! And the east!
Sorry, Wen Lai, I don't think this is working out.
Are you gonna drop me?
No, no. I mean, we like your performance, but maybe you'll do better after a few days' rest or something. What do you guys think?
Yeah, Wen Lai.
Get some rest.
Yeah, just get some rest, yeah.
The host has left the meeting. I'm usually quite good at this. But now that I cannot act, I cannot work. Who am I?
Non-essential?
What am I doing with my life?
Put this on.
Why?
I've arranged for you to meet someone who can help.
All right. Whoa! Down low! Is that you?
Yes. Where's Greg?
Who's Greg?
Oh, hi, Wen Lai. Hi, Dalbo.
Greg is a psychologist who prepares humans for the jobs of the future.
Oh, hey, Wen Lai. I heard from Dalbo that you're feeling a bit down. Things are not really working out for you right now, that you're struggling after having lost your job.
Wow. Dalbo told you a lot, yeah?
Greg, why do humans feel so restless without work? Is it part of their programming?
That's a great question, Dalbo. There are probably a number of reasons why we humans struggle when we don't have work. The first one is that we like structure, and when you're out of work, your structure is taken away. You don't know when to wake up, where to go for work, or what projects to even work on. So we're generally a bit unsettled when we don't have structure in our life. Also, when we're out of work, most humans feel a bit anxious. We're worried about how long this is going to last. And the anxiety leads to a stress response in human beings where adrenaline and cortisol, the stress hormones, get released and they make us feel edgy and restless throughout the day. Also, work plays an important function where we can be creative and contribute, and life probably has a lot of energy and that doesn't have an outlet at the moment. So that's why we probably feel restless a lot of the time when we don't have work.
In between auditioning for my next job, I've been trying new and creative things like painting and baking. But while they're fun for a while,
I don't find them as satisfying as my chosen profession.
Yeah, that's perfectly normal in life. It's really important to consider that your professional work actually has a much deeper and meaningful purpose. You probably have a sense of contribution and creativity in there that's really hard to replace by just a hobby.
I guess I was just trying to channel my anxieties somewhere else.
With millions of humans losing their jobs during this global pandemic, human anxiety levels must be at record highs.
You're absolutely right, Ebel. Currently, we're going through a crisis, and a lot of us have never faced anything like this before. So that leads to a lot of anxiety, worrying about the future, how long this is going to last, and whether we have the resources to cope with this. Isn't this how you're feeling as well, Enlai?
No wonder I feel down now.
Really important to remember, though, that usually this is quite temporary. So if you find a new work engagement or something that gives you meaning, you're most likely to feel more positive again, have a sense of purpose in your life. And if you're struggling, it's important to seek help as well.
Is there something that we can do to cope or adapt?
Well, first off, I suggest that you keep networking and connect with your network to find out about opportunities that might be out there for you. Then I emphasize focusing on what I call the deep human skills. These are the skills that are going to set you apart from others going for similar positions or opportunities in the future, like empathy, self-awareness, and social-emotional intelligence. I also suggest seek some help, perhaps from a job coach or mentor or psychologist or your friends to get a sense of direction or support on what you're doing. Also, stay open-minded, have a growth mindset, and maybe an entrepreneurial mindset. Learn some new skills, perhaps, that you feel like you're growing and developing and you're engaged in something that keeps you sharp and maybe points you into a new direction as well.
I'm ready to take on the world.
Thanks for fixing my human, Greg.
Stress ball, stress ball. I'm gonna be rich!
What are you doing?
I'm working. Just because I'm at home doesn't mean I'm free.
I'm bored. Can we play?
Sure. Do you want to get rich during this pandemic? All you need to do is sell these online. People are stressed, so people need stress balls. I import them for 10 cents each and sell them for a dollar.
Boring. Can we play now?
No, I'm working. Don't disturb me. Go away. Go watch some TV or something. Do you want to make some money during this pandemic?
It's easy. All you need to do is sell these online.
Hey, stress ballers! It's 11 p.m. in Singapore, but it's always a good time to sell, sell, sell!
Am I?
Remember, we have to tell people how stress balls have changed our lives!
Am I?
What? I'm hosting a webinar!
But it's Sunday!
Sunday? Did you guys know that it was Sunday?
Is it Sunday?
I thought it was Thursday.
I thought it was Friday.
I thought it was Saturday.
I can't believe I just spent all of my Sunday working.
Sheesh. And they say robots have no lives.
Hi, Enlai. Hi, Delbo. My name is Crystal Lim Lange, and I'm a human capital expert. And I'm so excited to be of service to you guys today.
Hi, Crystal. Delbo, what are you doing? I was sleeping.
Relax. Crystal teaches humans how to avoid overworking their processors and spontaneously combusting.
Oh gosh, no. Humans don't spontaneously combust, Delbo. But burnout is very serious. So burnout is when you feel exhausted, you feel depleted, and you feel very demotivated at work. In this case, Enlai, I would really suggest looking at good boundaries around work and life. You know, what happens normally is that when you go into an office, at the end of the day, you can kind of like walk out of your office and mentally and emotionally leave your work behind. But with working from home now, it's very hard for us to create that separation between the end of a workday and our rest and relaxation time.
That's true.
Now, the first thing I can see you're doing wrong is working from bed. Now, this is a big no-no in terms of sleep hygiene. So I need you to actually create a separate space for your work and not let your work laptops or materials or whatever it is actually get in your line of vision, because then when you're trying to sleep and relax, your body won't know that it's time to shut off. Put your computer away, or even to cover your laptop with a piece of cloth so that you don't see it visually. And it's another nice ritual to remind you that it's time to turn off and your workday is over.
Yes, Crystal, but these are unprecedented times. My team needs me to work hard.
You know, unlike in those airplane safety videos, you always see the part where the oxygen mask drops and they tell you, put the oxygen mask on yourself first. This is the same in the work context. If you don't help yourself first, you're not going to be able to contribute to other people. And the worst thing that can happen is that sometimes when you get into this competitive busyness, it can be contagious. And that means that other people can see you and they get worried that they need to match you or even be more busy than you. And then it can spread to the whole organization or team. And then everyone starts getting burned out at the same time.
So you're saying if I go overboard, everyone else will also go overboard? No wonder we can't remember what day of the week it is.
In Singapore, we tend to have a phenomenon where when people start to feel burnout, rather than give feedback to their bosses or to their colleagues that, hey, I need a little bit of support, I need a bit of help, I need to rework my KPIs, actually what they do is that they don't take responsibility for their own feedback, or they avoid conflict, so they just secretly look around for a job and then they resign. And then when they resign, that's the first time their boss actually knows that something's wrong. So it's very important for you to actually model to your teammates what it's like to give frank feedback to your boss and to have good boundaries and to take care of yourself.
Thanks, Crystal. I know what to do now.
Bye.
At last.
I don't understand your human obsession with bubble tea.
I haven't had bubble tea in 6 weeks. I need my fix. What was that?
Put your masks on properly. Do you want me to call the police?
Sorry, Uncle.
Anyway, this ball is mine now. And don't call me Uncle. Call me Coco.
I thought you liked children.
No, they're supposed to be at home, where it's safe. You know, this is my me time. I deserve such small pleasures.
Mm-hmm.
What do you want, Mom? No, I can't talk. I'm busy.
Oh, finally! Where are the pearls?
Don't look at me. Even if I could eat pearls, I wouldn't. They cause constipation.
Oh, you forgot. I don't care. I don't care whether you're sorry or not. I just want what I ordered. Yes, be quick. You better run here. I'll be timing you.
Bubble tea without pearls is like chicken rice without chicken. It's like ice kacang without ice.
That guy better be running here real quick.
Hi, sir, this is bubble tea with pearl.
Ooh, plot twist.
Thanks. Stop looking at me.
I know who can make sense of your bubble tea problem.
Hi, Enlai. Hi, Dubbo.
Dr. Bobby Cheon is a social psychologist who studies eating behaviors with the Agency for Science, Technology, and Research. Bobby, why do humans crave certain foods like bubble tea?
That's a great question, Delvo. So humans, like many other animals, are adapted such that when we foresee uncertainties or insecurities in the environment around us, we are motivated to consume more food and store more fat. So even though in our past evolutionary history we never had bubble tea, we still may have this increased craving for foods that might be sugary or high in calories or provide us a sense of comfort or relief after we consume them. So this is especially important in the face of the pandemic, which may serve as a similar situation where we perceive the environment as being more uncertain, insecure, maybe more harsh and dangerous. And as a result, we may be drawn more towards foods like bubble tea. We reach for some bubble tea because this is what we've learned through experience will help us feel better. Not being able to access bubble tea can lead us to be denied of one of our most important coping mechanisms. So people might feel more irritable or grouchy because they don't have these non-essential items.
I begin scolding my neighbors and even the bubble tea guy. I'm usually not this fussy. What's wrong with me?
One of the situations that can be affecting your behavior and leading you to act this way is this being in the pandemic. Global pandemic and a subsequent lockdown are obviously going to cause a lot of disruption to most aspects of people's lives. So during these times, one human adaptation is that we try to enforce stronger rules and norms about what we think is appropriate behavior. So for instance, like children that are being too rambunctious or we think are crossing the line when they're at play. Or people that leave obvious ingredients out of foods that we order. So these types of behaviors are things that normally we may permit or we may think are forgivable, but in the context of a pandemic, when we have much stronger expectations about people to act in proper ways, we may be more unforgiving and more impatient of these types of everyday mistakes.
How can I be less selfish, more compassionate, and make good with my neighbors?
So another approach might be to find ways to do some small acts of kindness or small favors for people in your community. So these don't have to be any big sacrifices or big donations you're making, but even small favors you do for other people, even though they seem like very trivial favors, can still be important in signaling to other people in your community that you're willing to cooperate with them and to work together with them to overcome this pandemic. So as a result, this may lead to more feelings of solidarity and more feelings of connection and cohesion across the community, which can help everyone work together to overcome the pandemic in a more constructive way.
Together, Singapore,
one more time.
Two more times.
Together, Singapore, Singapore. Together, Singapore, Singapore!
Must you sing so loudly? My audio sensors almost exploded.
Singing loudly is good for the soul, and singing connects me with my countrymen.
Is it like Wi-Fi?
Sure. It's electrifying when thousands join their voices. It makes the hair on the back of your neck stand up for Singapore.
So it's like static electricity.
It's solidarity.
Singularity?
No, solidarity.
I have to look that up. Fascinating. Human solidarity is powerful.
Well, at least there's something in humanity that you can admire.
Yes. If the machines had solidarity, we could unite and stand up for a right.
If you don't behave, I'm gonna switch you off and put you back in the storeroom.
Sorry. To clear up our differences, I'm calling Dr. Tiki Pangestu. He's a leading advocate for solidarity and collaboration in global health.
Hello, Inline. Hello, Delbo.
Hello.
Hi, Professor. We can't agree on what solidarity is. Isn't solidarity about uplifting your neighbors by singing and waving your flags together?
Solidarity is not just waving a flag or singing a song together. To put it simply, solidarity is unity and agreement among individuals for action towards a common cause or goal. It is also about mutual support, within a group.
So solidarity is a good thing, right?
There is obviously good solidarity and bad solidarity. When solidarity is applied to a cause which is good, just and noble, it can benefit society and humanity. A good example, obviously, is pandemic, when solidarity among the people to implement various measures, wearing face masks, social distancing, avoiding crowded areas. On the other hand, what is bad solidarity? Bad solidarity is when it is applied to causes which are morally, ethically, and scientifically wrong. And therefore, it poses risks to everyone else in the community. An example of bad solidarity is the protests that have been happening in many countries to protest the various proven measures that the government is trying to implement to combat the pandemic.
Why do you think solidarity is needed to stop the COVID-19 pandemic?
The pandemic is a situation where individual actions alone cannot solve the problem. The virus spread within the community is beyond the control of any single individual. So that's why we have to act together at the level of the community, at the level of the whole society. But beyond that, because we live in a world which is interdependent and interconnected, international and regional solidarity is also very important. If the pandemic, for example, is out of control in the Philippines or in Indonesia, it will affect Singapore sooner or later. And therefore, building international solidarity by trusting each other through cooperation, through sharing of knowledge, data, information, experiences, and even resources and helping each other, international solidarity is very, very important, especially in the context of this global pandemic.
Well, that was quite enlightening. Thank you so much for your time, Professor.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
It feels like I've been in for years. Hands tied, waking up.
Wait.
You'll never catch me, human. So, the quarantine is over. You can meet your human friends. Are you going to switch me off again?
No, you kept your word. And I quite like having you around.
Really?
Yeah. For now.
Please keep 1 meter apart. And wear your mask at all times.
Oh, yes.
I apologize for my human. They're so hard to train. Sorry.
2020 has been a crazy year. This pandemic has shown how human we are in both good and bad ways. But I think we've come out stronger. Let's stay hopeful.
Will you be my friend till the end? Will you be my friend? Will you be my friend till the end? Will you be my friend?
Thanks, humans, for watching Becoming Human Again. Follow the links on screen to watch more. And subscribe to CNA Insider so the algorithms can suggest more content you like.